بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين حبيب إله العالمين المصطفى أبي القاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المنتجبين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فمما جاء من كلام سيدنا ومولانا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم أنه قال كمل من الرجال كثير ولم يكمل من الرجال من النساء إلا أربع آسيا بنت مزاحم زوجة فرعون ومريم ابنة عمران وخديجة بنت خويلد وفاطمة بنت محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد Tonight, inshallah, we'll be discussing about this noble lady, السيدة الطاهرة خديجة الكبرى صلوات الله وسلامه عليها. Our discussion, inshallah, will be in three main points. First, we will briefly discuss the greatness of this noble lady, عظمت السيدة خديجة سلام الله عليها. Second, briefly we'll discuss some of her history, سلام الله عليها. And third, we'll finish with a couple of points that we can draw and lessons that we can implement in our daily life, inshallah, in this day and age. So with regards to the first point, the greatness of As-Sayyida Khadija, how great is this lady? How noble is she? In here, we'll take a look at two points, inshallah. One is Ziyarat Warith. In Ziyarat Warith for Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhi salam, we say, As-salamu alayka yabna Khadijat al-Kubra. Peace be upon you, O son of Khadijat al-Kubra. Allah chose this noble lady to become the mother of As-Sayyida Zahra alayhi salam, who was the mother of Al-Imam Al-Hasan and Imam Al-Husayn and the nine progeny, the nine descendants of Al-Imam Al-Husayn alayhim as-salam. Alayhim as-salam. In the same ziyarah, after we say As-Salamu Alayka Yabna Khadijat Al-Kubra, we also read Ya Aba Abdullah Ashhadu Annaka Kunta what? Nuran fil aslab al-shamikha wal arham al-mutahhara. I bear witness that you were a light, a nur, in the loins, the respected loins. Nur here, it's not the topic of my discussion, nor do I want to spend time on it, because that's a topic on its own. What does it mean that he is Nur fil aslab al-shamikha? However, Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam have the physical characteristics, and they have the other side, the Nurani side, the light. We read in Ziyar al-Jami' al-Kabira, and you were, Ya Ahlul Bayt, Ya Ahlul Bayt, you were Anwar, Bi'arshillahi Muhdiqeen, Famanallahu Bikum Alayna. That you were these Anwar, these lights, that were attached to the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is resembled by the throne of Allah. You were lights, nur, anwar. And then Allah bestowed you as a favor upon us in this earth. He brought you down to this earth as a favor upon us. فَمَنَّ bikum alayna. So Ahlul Bayt have that nur aspect of that light aspect of that. And here's where I'll stop on this discussion here. Nonetheless, we continue. I bear witness that you were nur, anwar, nuran. Fil aslab al-shamikha, in the respected loins, wal arham al-mutahhara, and the purified wombs. The hadith states that all the forefathers of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, up to Adam, from Adam to Abdullah and Amina alayhim as-salam, all of them were muwahideen, all were believers. Not only this, the hadith also says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi always in the best of his creation at that time. Yani, for example, Ibrahim had two sons. Do you know the names? Yes, what are they? Prophet Ishaq and a prophet Ismail alayhi salam. Ismail was the eldest, Ishaq was the youngest. Who was the forefather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Ishaq or Ismail? Ismail, salamullahi alayhi. So it means of the two, Ismail was the better between Ismail and Ishaq alayhim as-salam. Because he was the forefather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He carried Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And so on and so forth. All the descendants of Ismail alayhi salam up to Abdullah and Amina, they were the best of Allah's creation at that time, in their times. They are all muwahideen. The Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, Allah did not keep me in any forefather who was a mushrik. And that's the meaning of al-aslab al-shamikha wal-arham al-mutahhara, the purified wombs. This suggests to us how great this lady is. Lady Mutahhara Khadijah is also a grandmother of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. So she is Mutahhara, she is Tahira. Wal-arham al-mutahhara. On that same note, Imam al-Sajjad alayhi salam, also in Sham, in his khutbah, he also says, Anabnu safiyyat al-juyub, naqiyyat al-uyub, Anabnu Fatimata al-Zahra, Anabnu Khadijah al-Kubra. I am the son of those who are free from impurities, from mistakes, from any deficiencies. I am the son of Fatima and Khadijah. He also mentions Khadijah salamullahi alayha. So this lady was not an ordinary lady. She was a lady whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to be the wife of Rasulullah, the best of his creation, and the mother of Fatima salamullahi alayha. So this lady was not an ordinary lady. This is with regards to this ziyarat warith. Also, in the hadith that we just recited from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, where he says, many men have achieved the status of perfection. Of the women, four of them achieved that status. And they are Asiya, the wife of the Pharaoh, bint Mazahim, Maryam, the mother of Isa alayhi salam, wa alayha salam, and Khadijah, as well as Fatima salamullahi alayha. So these are the virtuous, noble lady who have achieved the status of perfection. On that matter of perfection, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, when I was ascended to the heavens, bil mi'raj, I saw Jibra'il, and at one point I thought to Jibra'il, is there anything that I can do for you, ya Jibra'il? You know, just before leaving, he says, yes. أقرأ عن خديجة عن الله وعن السلام. أقرأ خديجة عن الله وعن السلام. Tell, send my salam to Khadija and the salam of Allah. Tell Khadija that Allah and I, Jibra'il, send the salam to her. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi descended. He saw Khadijah salamullahi alayha. He told her, Ya Khadijah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَجِبْرَئِيلِ يُقْرِئَانَكِ السَّلَامِ Allah and Jibreel send their salam to you. Now listen to the answer. She said, اللَّهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ السَّلَامِ وَمِنْهُ السَّلَامِ وَإِلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ بعدين وَعَلَى جِبْرَئِيلِ السَّلَامِ Look at the difference. Pay attention. She did not say, وَعَلَى اللَّهِ وَعَلَى جِبْرَئِيلِ السَّلَامِ Do you understand? She did not say, when someone says, Salamu alaykum, what do you say? وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامِ It's wajib. However, when the salam comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is the source of the salam. He is the essence of salam. He is as-salam. هو الكمال المطلق. So you don't say وعليك السلام to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You say it upon the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khadijah had that much understanding, that much knowledge, that much comprehension of the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi told her, Ya Khadijah, Allah and His and Jibreel send you the salam, she immediately said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ السَّلَامِ Surely Allah is the salam, is the greatest salam. As-salam in Asma'illah al-Husna. It's one of Allah's greatest names. As-salam. Surely Allah is the salam, the source of salam. وَمِنْهُ السَّلَامِ He's the essence of salam. وَإِلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ And to Him goes the salam. And then, and peace be upon Jibreel. وَعَلَى جِبْرَئِيلَ السَّلَامِ The mere fact that Khadija salamullahi alayha understood that, realized that, also demonstrates how great this lady is. This gives us some understanding how noble this lady is. Next, we come to the history of this lady briefly. This lady was from Quraysh. In her forefathers, she goes back to Qusay, and therefore that is the great-great-grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. So in other words, she was a cousin to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. She's also of the descendants of Ismail. Alayhi salam. This lady was very noble in Quraysh. She was known to be a very wealthy businesswoman. Many people in Quraysh came to approach her for marriage, but she rejected them all. As we mentioned in the first point, she was a muwahhida, she was a believer. She believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She was tahira. So she was not just an ordinary woman. Until the time came when Abu Talib alayhi salam told his nephew, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, many people go to Khadija to do business in her money. And then they divide the profits accordingly. That's what we call in Islam, mudharabah. Mudharabah is when you do a partnership. A person says, for example, I don't have the money, but I have the idea, or I have the power, I can work. Another person says, well, I have the money, but I don't have time, nor do I have the idea. So how about we do a partnership? I'll give you the money, you do the work, and then we'll split the profits, whatever you decide, 50-50, 60-40, whatever, based on that. That's called mudharabah. In that context of mudharabah, it's a contractual concept, which is different from the loan concept. What do we mean by this? Loan, you go to the bank today, they give you a loan. The bank is not a partner in your business. That doesn't care. He's giving you a loan and he wants interest. The bank wants its interest. You have to pay back the loan. And then you will use the business, for example, as a guarantee. If you don't pay back the loan, they will come and take your business. Or they'll come and take your home. That's the loan system, the interest system. That is not an allowed system in Islam. Now, of course, that does not mean we can't take loans from the bank. Our fuqaha say it's permissible to get loans from the bank and buying homes. That's in a special talk on its own, but it is permissible to go and get a mortgage and buy a house, buy a car, etc., etc., etc. That's permissible. Nonetheless, the system of interest in itself is the answer to today's modern world. In Islam, it has a system of mudaraba. Mudaraba is partnership. In other words, I care about your success because I have my money in there. So I will make sure to whom I give my money to. And I will make sure to help you succeed to the best of your ability because my money is with you. I will not give money to any person who walks through the doors. I will do some scrutiny. Second, I will work with them. I will try to help him draw some business plan. This is what we call today venture capitalism or angel investors, for example. That's what they sometimes do. That system is called the system of mudaraba. When I was teaching a course just last term at the university, in one of the universities in Edmonton, I spoke to them. I told them the main difference between the Islamic financial system and the world's financial system that is mostly established today, the interest system, is that the Islamic system is a contractual system. It's based on contracts. That you do a contract with the other party. And that contract has the interest of both parties. And that's why it's a different system from the interest system. Now, of course, it's a bit more complex than this. I'm oversimplifying it here. Nonetheless, this was Khadija, salamullahi alayha. This is what she used to do. She had the money, but she needed people to go and do the business. Abu Talib told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, at the time, this is before his ba'tha, he told him, why don't you go? You're such a noble man. So he approached Khadija and Khadija accepted. Khadija took two of her servants. She told them, you go with the Prophet, with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. Sallu ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajil farajah. And be at your service because this man is Sayyidu Quraysh. This prophet, this man, he is the leader of Quraysh. He was very well respected by Quraysh. Even though he was young, even though he was orphaned, his father Abdullah died before his birth. Yet he is the head of Quraysh. He's one of the heads of Quraysh. So respect him and listen to him in whatever he asks you to do. And indeed, they go, those two servants, they go with those two slaves, they go with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi. He goes to Sham, he comes back. Khadija asks them what happened in the journey. Both of them tell her that we have seen of this man some wonders. Ajaib. This man is not an ordinary man. And that's in addition to the reputation of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, which was already in Quraysh, that he is as-sadiq al-amin. The truthful, the honest. He was well respected. People liked him, respected him. So when she saw all these merits of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, she sent a message to his uncles that I would like to marry Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. The uncle sent their sister, Safiya. Safiya. They told her, Ya Safiya. She's the mother of Zubair, by the way. Safiya. Zubair ibn al-Awam, the son of Safiya. So Safiya, they said, go and talk to Khadija. So she went. She investigated. Khadija, yes. She showed her interest. Safiya came back to Abu Talib. And she told him that I'm bringing you some great news. Khadija is accepting to marry Muhammad. Sallu ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajil farajah. So they go to her father Khuwaylid. The father says, sure, I don't have a problem, but Khadija is a lady who really manages her own affairs. She's independent. So why don't you ask her? He said, let's go. So they went with him to her, and she accepted the proposal. And that's how that blessed marriage took place between a Sayyida Khadija and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Now, what's important here is, what was the age of a Sayyida Khadija at the time of the marriage? And this is where it's different. صلى على محمد وآل محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل. And here it's where they hear some differences. Some say that she was how old? What's the common thing that you heard? What's the age? 40 years old. That has become the famous age, that Khadija was 40 when the Prophet was how old? 25. The Prophet is 25, she is 40 years old. That is the famous thing that's out there. Many people say this. Recently, we've had a alim by the name of As-Sayyid Ja'far Murtada Al-Amili. He's written some books where he's researched these things. And one of those books is called As-Sahih Min Sirat Al-Nabi Al-A'zam Sallallahu Alaihi Wa Alihi Wasallam. صلوا على محمد اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد وعجل وجل. In that book, he's researched this. Was she really 40? The age of the Prophet, yes, he was 25. But what was the age of Khadija? What's important here is some people take advantage of that age difference. How so? They say, well, here is a young man, 25. Why would he want to marry a 40-year-old woman? If indeed he is so handsome, he is so respected, he must have really been interested in her money. Why else would you want to marry a 40-year-old woman when you're only 25? That's what some people argue and accuse Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. After doing the research, As-Sayyid Ja'far Murtada Al-Amili comes to the conclusion she must have been approximately 28 years old at the time of marriage to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. I'm not going to go get into the details of the research, but I've given you the reference. You can look into it. As-Sahih Min Sirat Al-Nabi Al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi by Sayyid Ja'far Murtada Al-Amili. So that's where he says she was about 28 years old. That's one. Second, was Khadija married before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Did she have children from some other people before Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? In another book by Sayyid Ja'far Murtada Al-Amili, he has another book called Banatu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi Am Raba'ibah aw Raba'ibah, the daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, or the children whom he raised. Are they his own daughters or are they girls that he raised? In that book, again, he's done the research, the historical research. I'll give you the conclusion of the research. You can go back to the book and read it if you wish. The conclusion is Khadija salamullahi alayha had a sister by the name of Hala. Hala had married a man. And that man, from him she had children. That man then died. Hala married another man. That other man had daughters from a previous marriage and had children with the sister of Khadija. Among those children were a boy called Hind, and two girls, Ruqayya and Zainab. That father died. The sister of Khadija also died. So these girls or these children were left with no one to take care of them. The boy, his uncles from the father's side, they said, you know what, we'll take care of the boy. No, bring him to us, we'll raise him. But the girls, they were left. So Khadija said, come to me. She took them, Zainab and Ruqayya, and she raised them. Because they were raised in the house of Khadija, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi then married Khadija, and they came to the house of Khadija and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Therefore, usually, who raised them? Rasulullah and Khadija. Now, when someone raises orphans, little kids, what do they usually call these people? Sometimes they call them parents. Baba, mama, father, mother. However, they were not the children, the biological children of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi from Khadija. He raised them, but they were not his own children. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi had some children with Khadija salamullahi alayhi. In fact, all his children came from Khadija with the exception of one boy whom he had from one of his wives in Medina later on by the name of Maria. Maria al-Qubtiyya. She delivered Ibrahim, but he died at a young age. He died at a young age, Ibrahim. Otherwise, all the Prophet's children came from Khadija. She delivered Al-Qasim, and that's why the kunya of Rasulullah is Abu al-Qasim, but he died young. She delivered Al-Tahir, whose name is also Abdullah, Abdullah Al-Tahir, but he also died young. And she may have delivered some girls as well, Ruqayya, Zainab, Umm Kulthum, but they also died young. The only child who survived was who? As-Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayha. She was the only child of the Prophet from his marriage to Khadija who survived. The rest all died. And they all died young. The only one who survived was Sayyida Fatima salamullahi alayha. And she was the one who then married Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi in Medina. This is important to suggest that the only daughter, biological daughter, who the Prophet had was a Sayyida Fatima alayha salam, who survived. And hence she married Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi. What historians, some historians, especially at the time of Bani Umayyah tried to put some ahadith to decrease the status of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, to attack the Prophet himself. They put ahadith to attack Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. In fact, wal'iyadu billah, they used to do the la'an of Amir al-Mu'mineen. They used to use inappropriate words against Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi. And this is found in Sahih Muslim. Open Sahih Muslim. You find Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan في كتاب فضائل الصحابة باب فضائل علي بن أبي طالب عليه السلام عليه السلام مني مو منه. In there he shows a hadith where Muawiyah orders, he blames سعد بن أبي وقاص. Why do you لما لا تسب عليا? Why do you not do the سب? Use inappropriate foul language against علي بن أبي طالب. How come? So سعد بن أبي وقاص answered him. He said, because he married the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. He was the father of Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, the only children of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And he was the one about whom the Prophet said on the day of Khaybar, لَأُعْطِيَنَّ الرَّايَ لِرَجُلٍ يُحِبُّهُ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ وَيُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ كَرَّارٌ لَيْسَ بِفَرَّارٍ يَجْعَلُ اللَّهُ الْفَتْحَ عَلَى يَدَيْهِ. And he gave it to Ali ibn Abi Talib. In the day of Khaybar, the Prophet said, I'm going to give the banner, the leadership tomorrow to a man who Allah and his messenger love him. And he loves Allah and his messenger. He is a victorious man who will bring victory to the Muslims. And he gave that banner to Ali ibn Abi Talib. For these three reasons, I wish I had one of those merits. I wish I had married Fatima alayhi salam. I had that honor. I wish I had children like Hassan and Hussein, who are grandchildren of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And I wish I was the one chosen. For these three reasons, I will never use foul language against Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's in Sahih Muslim. So this is Bani Umayyah, who have put a hadith against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. A hadith against Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. They fabricated a hadith against As-Sayyidah Zahra salamullahi alayha. A hadith against Abu Talib salamullahi alayhi. So you think they will leave Khadijah out? Why would they leave her out? If they can decrease her status and raise the status of others. No, it is not Khadijah, the most favorite wife. It was another wife who was never married before. That wife was the only wife the Prophet married who was not married before. It's that lady, not this lady. And why say Ali ibn Abi Talib married Fatima? So what? If he married one daughter, Uthman ibn Affan married two daughters of Rasulullah, the Nurain. Ali عنده نور واحد, Uthman عنده نورين. If Ali has one of the light, one of the daughters, Uthman has two. What's important to note is if Uthman had married those girls, they were not the biological daughters of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. The only biological daughter who survived was a Sayyida Fatima salamullahi alayha. So history was not fair to a Sayyida Khadija salamullahi alayha. Some historians were not fair to her. And that's why in his book, As-Sayyid Ja'far Murtada al-Amili, in both of those books that I referenced, As-Sahih min Sirat al-Nabi al-A'zam sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and Banatu Rasulillah Amra Ba'ibih, in those two, he's done the historical analysis where he brings you all the references. So for detailed analysis, go check those references. Where he comes to this conclusion that As-Sayyida Khadija salamullahi alayha was about 28 years of age when she married Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. And she had never been married before to anyone else. She married only Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. She did not have any children from any previous marriage. The only children she had was from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, but they all died at young age with the exception of Fatima salamullahi alayha. She's the only surviving child who grew up and had children. That's important here. This noble lady, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam, says in Nahjul Balagha, there was no house that united people in Islam except the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, consisting of himself, Khadija, and I. This is Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam in Nahjul Balagha. The only house that united people, everyone in that house was a Muslim, was the house of Rasulullah, himself, Khadija, and I. And Afif al-Kindi says, I came to visit Mecca for business. I stayed with Al-Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib, the uncle of the Prophet. Him and I were sitting near the Masjid al-Haram. I saw a man, young man, come, and he faced the Kaaba, he raised his hand, and then he started praying. Then shortly after, a young boy came and stood next to him, or just behind him, on his right-hand side. And then a lady came behind them, and she prayed with them. I asked Al-Abbas, I said, Ya Abbas, Ya Aba al-Fadl, what is this? What's going on? Who are these people? He said, this man who's leading in the front is my nephew, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi Muhammad wa alayhi. The young boy you see praying next to him, just a little bit on his right, is my other nephew, Ali ibn Abi Talib. And the lady behind him is Khadija. They are the only ones united on this religion, praying. And my nephew, the Prophet, he claims that he is a prophet of God and he is receiving revelation from heavens. This further demonstrates that they were the first people to believe in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Then comes Abu Talib alayhi salam with Ja'far al-Tayyar, was a little boy as well. Ja'far was about a teenager because he's 10 years older than Amir al-Mu'mineen. So if Imam Ali alayhi salam was 7, 8 or 10 years old, Ja'far would have been 17, 18 or give or take about 20 years old maximum. Abu Talib brings Ja'far and he says, "Sil janahabna ammik." Go pray on the other side. So Ja'far goes and joins them as well in the salat as well. As Sayyida Khadija then spends the time with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi after the religion of Islam, after the ba'tha, and she spends all her money serving Islam. When she married the Prophet, the women of Quraysh boycotted her. They told her, the men of Quraysh, the elites, the wealthy people, all came to marry you. You rejected them all and you married the orphan of Quraysh, yatim Quraysh. This man who's poor. So they boycotted her. By the way, this is a further evidence that she had never married anyone else before. Why would they boycott her? They told her, all the elites of Quraysh came to marry you. You refused them all. So then who was the husband of Khadijah? If she had married before, who was this person? He must have been an honorable person, otherwise the ladies of Quraysh would have made fun of her. Well, if it's an honorable person, how come history did not really report his name accurately? This is further evidence she never married anyone else before Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nonetheless, they came, they boycotted her. They stopped communicating with her. She became alone. However, did that deter a Sayyida Khadija? Was she complaining? Never. Never. Even when she became pregnant with Fatimah al-Zahra alayha salam, she used to get lonely. So the Prophet one day came to visit her. He saw her talking to someone. He said, "Who are you talking to, Ya Khadija?" She said, "Ya Rasulullah, I am lonely. As you know, the women are not talking to me anymore. But the fetus in my womb is talking to me. It's having a conversation. It's keeping me company." He said, "Yes, Ya Khadija. Allah told me this is a virtuous lady. This is going to be a virtuous girl whom Allah will bless us with. And she will be Sayyidatu Nisa'il Alameen." She's a great lady. So Khadija was alone at the time of delivery of Fatima alayha salam. Again, the women of Quraysh boycotted her. Allah sent to her Sarah, the wife of Ibrahim, Asiya bint Mazahim, Maryam ibn Umran, wa Kaltham ukht Musa, the sister of Musa. Allah sent those four to her to help her with the delivery of As-Sayyida Zahra salamullahi alayha. She was all alone. Then they were boycotted. Did she ever complain to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi? Did she ever tell him, "Ya Rasulullah, before you I was a virtuous lady, a great lady. Look at, after I married you, nothing. All the women boycotted me." Did she ever speak anything? Wal-iyadu billah, never. Never. Did she ever complain? Never. Did she listen to what the other women were telling her? Never. Because she knew what she was doing is haqq. This is right. This is correct. And this takes me to the third point before I conclude. My brothers and sisters, in this day and age, you have a lot of people who come and they make fun. Hijab? Why do you wear hijab? How come in this heat in the winter or the summer, for example, it's hot in the summer, you're wearing hijab? Or why don't you guys, for example, you know, have friends, you know, girlfriends? Why don't you have this? They'll make fun. When we know what we are doing is haqq, is correct, then we should not care about what people say to us. When you know what you're doing is right, Khadija salamullahi alayha, she also suffered from what we call today peer pressure. The women of Quraysh all boycotted her. They were putting pressure on her. Did she succumb? No, she didn't. She knew what she was doing was right. This is a very important lesson. People will come to you throughout your lives and they will start making a whole bunch of decisions for you. You think about it. Consult, if you're young, consult the elders, especially your parents. If you are older, even consult dawil khibra, the people who have expertise. Ask them before jumping into it. We should not be people who listen to anyone, anything, because people sometimes, even if they were genuine, their circumstances could be different from yours. A man comes to another man, tells him, you know, how many children you have? He says, well, I have one child. Well, one only? How come? How come only one? You should have five. And then this man starts thinking, yeah, maybe I should have five. Goes and has a fight with his wife. You know, I need five children. You know, why? Well, my friends have five. I want five as well. Or the ladies would come to the husband, to the wife, and say, you know, how much gold has your husband bought you? You know, how much does he buy you? Does he buy you, you know, Mother's Day? Did he bring you a gift? Mother's Day? Any gift for Mother's Day? No gift? Astaghfirullah. How can you live with such a stingy man? And if the wife was not even thinking about it, she starts thinking about it sometimes. Did he bring you flowers? You know? We see some people here with flowers, alhamdulillah, rabbil alameen. I guess, mashallah, you know, you guys are giving out flowers tonight, mashallah. So people sometimes, they don't understand the circumstances, even if they were genuine. I mean, maybe he has certain circumstances that only allows him for one child. Khalas, that's it. Mind your own business. He has certain circumstances, he can't buy so much gold, for whatever reason. We should not be talking about this and this. Why do you have this? Why do you not? We should mind our own business and think about what is right and what is wrong, what is haq and what is batil. Adhere to the haq. This world, especially today, now for you, back the youth, it has so much pressures. You go to class, your friends will ask you, which level are you at in Fortnite? Which season are you? You'll be like, well, I'm still in season two. What, season two? Ooh, old school. I am in this. And people might make fun. Girls, same thing. And so on and so forth. We should not listen to what people say. We should do what's haq, what's right. You tell them, listen, I will do whatever my parents are happy with, whatever Allah is happy with. I read this ayah to you before, but I'll read it again. In Surah Al-Mutaffifin, Allah says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ أَجْرَمُوا كَانُوا مِنَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَضْحَكُونَ يَضْحَكُونَ وَإِذَا مَرُّوا بِهِمْ يَتَغَامَزُونَ يَغْمُزُوهُمْ بِالْكَلَامِ. Indeed, those who were corrupt, أجرم, مجرمين, corrupt, when they used to look at the believers, they used to make fun of them. What, you don't have a girlfriend? What, you wear hijab in this heat? Oh, you can't join us? You can't play sports with us? Oh, too bad, I feel sorry for you. Tell them, no, don't feel sorry for me. Because on the day of judgment, you're the one who's gonna have to feel sorry for yourself. And the ayah says later on, two, three ayahs later, Allah says, فَالْيَوْمْ يعني يوم القيامة فَالْيَوْمْ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ يَضْحَكُونَ. Today, the believers will start laughing at the kuffar. عَلَى الْأَرَائِكِ يَنظُرُونَ. They're sitting comfortably on the beautiful couches and they're looking at those people, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ, in the hellfire, being punished. هَلْ ثُوِّبَ الْكُفَّارُ مَا كَانُوا يَفْعَلُونَ. Did the kuffar get anything out of what they used to do? No. They ended up in Jahannam, وَالْعِيَاذُ بِاللَّهِ. So don't listen to what people say to you. If it's wrong, it's wrong. It's haram. Stay to the halal. This is a very important lesson we learn from a Sayyida Khadijah salamullahi alayha. She listened to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. She listened to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She didn't care. All the women of Quraysh went against her. All the people of Quraysh turned against her, except the few Muslims. Did that deter her? No. She invested her money in the akhirah, not in dunya. That's what you need to do. She spent all her money. Because we, unfortunately, don't see Jannah. We don't see the akhirah. Once we close our eyes in this dunya, that's when we'll realize how important it was when we donated to help the poor, when we gave to the others, when we invested in our akhirah. When you wear the hijab, my sisters, and you feel the heat, in dunya, sometimes you'll experience that. Very hot, very hot. And you might get, you know, dehydrated, really difficult. You'll feel the breeze of that coolness of wearing the hijab when you leave this dunya. I mentioned last night, few short life years in this dunya, but then the eternity in akhirah will be the victorious. People laugh at you because you don't know what your game you're playing, just like what you're playing right now. And because people, for example, are making fun, you don't have a girlfriend, you don't come partying with us, you don't drink, you don't whatever, tell them, yeah, I don't do any of these things. Rather, I'm gonna go to university, I'll get a good degree, I will have a good job, I'll have, inshallah, a good life. That's what my prospects in life are. That's what I'm gonna focus on. Focus on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, after 70 years, 100 years, God forbid, when we leave this dunya, at that time, then we'll be laughing. Like a Sayyida Khadijah, salamullahi alayha. She gave everything she had for the sake of Allah, such that when the time of her death came, she did not even have money to buy a kafan. Kafan. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi had to go buy her a kafan, get her a kafan. She did not even have money for a kafan. This wealthy lady, all her money was invested in her akhirah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi cried a lot. She died on the 10th day of the month of Ramadan, 3 years before Hijrah. 3 years before the Hijrah. That same year, Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet, also died. Most probably because of the suffering they endured in the sanctions that were imposed upon them by Quraysh. Because after the sanctions, when they came out, they both became so frail, so weak, they both died, salamullahi alayhima. And the Prophet called that year the year of mourning, the year of grief, Aam al-Huzn. The Prophet then put her in her kafan, took care of her, salamullahi alayha, went to her qabr in Hujun, today in Mecca, which unfortunately it had a shrine, but that shrine has been demolished. Inshallah, it will be rebuilt soon, inshallah, and we witnessed that. The Prophet went inside her grave. He lied down, and then he put her down in the grave, salamullahi alayha. After burying her, he came back to house. Who was there? As-Sayyida Fatima al-Zahra, salamullahi alayha. A little girl. She was about maybe 2-3 years of age. Or about, give or take, 5 years of age. She was about 5 years of age. She was 5 years of age. She saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. She said, "Father, where is my mother Khadija?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi didn't want to answer her. Jibra'il came down to him. He told him, "Ya Rasulullah, قل لفاطمة, say to Fatima, Khadija is in paradise, in Jannah, resting in a palace that is made up of jewels of Jannah. That's where she is." So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi comforted as Sayyida Fatima salamullahi alayha, that, "Ya Fatima, your mother now is in Jannah. She's in a palace decorated or made up of the jewels of Jannah. This lady, she invested in dunya, she gained in the akhirah." And Rasulullah took care of her burial, salamullahi alayha. We know her qabr, salamullahi alayha. We've been to her qabr. People, mu'mineen, go to visit her sometimes. They read her ziyara. But when the time came for the death of her daughter, Fatima, salamullahi alayha, she also died alone, just like her mother, Khadija. Except that Ramir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam buried her in the middle of the night and hid her grave as per her wasiyyah, her will. And it was difficult, just like it was difficult for a Sayyida Fatima losing her mother. A mother has a great status in the heart of her children. A mother cares for the children, looks after the children. She embraces them with her love, with her care. So losing the mother is painful to the children, those who are mu'mineen, those who are caring. And similarly, when Amir al-Mu'mineen buried Fatima salamullahi alayha, the mother of her children, of his children, he went to the qabr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, sat on the grave of Rasulullah crying. He said, قَلَّ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ عَنْ صَفِيَّتِكَ صَبْرِي وَرَقَّ عَنْهَا تَجَلُّدِي إِلَّا أَنَّ لِي فِي التَّأَسِّي بِعَظِيمِ فُقْدَتِكَ وَفَادِحِ مُصِيبَتِكَ مَوْضِعَ تَعَزٍّ فلقد أوسستك في ملحودة قبرك وفاضت بين صدري ونحري نفسك إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون لقد استرجعت الوديعة وأخذت الرهينة أما حزني فسرمد وأما ليلي أما حزني فسرمد وأما ليلي فمسهد حتى يختار الله لي دارك التي أنت فيها مقيم. Ya Rasulullah, it is painful for me losing your daughter Fatima salamullahi alayha. Indeed, the trust has come back to you now. And let her complain to you of what your nation has done against her. He used to go to the qabr of As-Sayyida Fatima salamullahi alayha, sit there, read the Quran at night when no one is around to see, because she asked him to do so. She said, come to my qabr, read the Quran, because the mayyit enjoys the recitation of the Quran. One night, his eyes snoozed a little. He saw a Sayyida Fatima. She said, Ya Ali, head back to the house. He said, why, Ya Fatima? Let me stay here a little bit longer. She said, go back. Zainab alayha salam, my little girl has just woken up and she's calling you. Amir al-Mu'mineen got up from his sleep, quickly went back to the house. He saw Zainab salamullahi alayha, who also was 5 years old when she lost her mother Fatima, just like her mother. She saw him, she cried, Aba ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. He said, yes, my beloved girl, why are you up? She said, father, I woke up, I know my mother is not here anymore. I didn't know what to do. I was crying. I remembered our mother Fatima. Imam al-Hasan, Imam al-Hussein used to remember their mother Fatima. الله يرحم كل الأمهات المتوفيات والباقيات الله يمد فيه صحتهن وعافيتهن ويغفر لهن جميعا يما تشلتل الليل بظلام يما ليلي ما أقدر أنا بعدك يتامى يتامى آه
في يوم العاشر من المحرم عندما نادت زينب أخي الحسين مهلا مهلا يا ابن الزهراء. قالت أخي افتح لي قميصك، فتح لها القميص، قبلته في صدره، شمته في نحره، قبلته في جبينه، ثم التفتت إلى المدينة وقالت السلام عليك يا أمه، لقد أديت الوصية. يا
أخي ما هي الوصية يا زينب؟
أخي أبا عبد الله، لما دنت الوفاة أمنا يا أخذت بيدي، قالت بني زينب في يوم العاشر من المحرم إذا رأيت الحسين وحيدا يا عني، هذه مني أنا الأم الحنون الأم الرؤوف، لن أكون موجودة في ذلك اليوم، قبليه في صدره، شميه في نحره، قبليه على جبينه. والآن أديت الوصية. لما سمع المولى اسم أمه فاطمة جرت دموعه على خده، توجه إلى المدينة وقال السلام عليك يا أمه. يا 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 ما أشوقني إليك، ماتت ولم تمت مكارمها السنية، بأبي التي دفنت وبقى قبرها السامي خفية، إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون، وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون، والعاقبة للمتقين. Let's read the ayah quickly. The time of iftar is here. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء، 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 أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. إلهي بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها، ارزقنا شفاعة الزهراء لنا ولذوينا يا الله. اللهم اجعلنا وذريتنا إلى يوم الدين من شيعة الزهراء المتقين وخدمة الحسين المخلصين يا الله. إلهي بباب الحوائج خديجة الكبرى اقضي حوائج المحتاجين يا الله. شافي وعافي جميع المرضى يا الله. اللهم واغفر لنا ولوالدينا وللمؤمنين والمؤمنات وارحمهما كما ربيانا صغارا. اللهم واجعل ذريتنا ذرية صالحة مؤمنة، وعجل لوليك الفرج، واجعلنا من شيعته وأنصاره. إلى أرواح أمواتنا وأموات الجالسين والحاضرين والشهداء والعلماء والفضلاء والمؤسسين والباذلين والمساهمين، وإلى أرواح كل المؤمنين والمؤمنات لا سيما الأمهات المؤمنات، رحم الله من يقرأ السورة المباركة الفاتحة مع الصلوات.